Beginnings, Tom, beginnings, beginnings. At the time, in my back pocket, I had an outline, or an idea, anyway, for a movie, and it was called Spaceballs.
It wasn't called Spaceballs originally, but it was...
What did we call it originally?
Originally, when you called me about it, first of all, we met around 1970, and you said, you know, you've got to work on a movie with me.
Yeah, but and then 10 years
like
later.
To, would you like to? And I said, yeah, here's my phone number. So for 14 years, I sat by the phone.
I finally called.
But anyway, it was called, when you first had it, it was called Planet Moron.
Planet Moron, Planet you remember that.
Yeah, yeah. And then we were meeting and we were talking and we had started doing an outline of Planet Moron and we heard that there was a some kind of British low-budget movie called Moron from Outer Space. So we said, we've got to get another title.
Yes.
So it was with Ronnie Graham, you and I were having lunch at 20th Century Fox and you said, well, you can't use Planet Moron, but you said, I think the first word should be space anyway. Space anything. So let's go through the alphabet.
And then I think I spilled something on me, and I said, balls. And then Ronnie said, that's it, space balls.
So there was the basic idea.
Something like
The idea was, we'll go through the alphabet. We'll start at A, we'll work and see where we're in space. Mm-hmm. So we're in space A, you know, space balls, you said.
That's
at the end. We don't have to go to C.
Yeah, and then we thought of, you know, space balls would be cute because they would all wear these balls as helmets, you know, white helmets.
Which they did do. Yeah.
And they would be aggressive, which would work into the title, and... Yeah. And then we came up with a great idea for a premise for a space movie. At the time, Star Wars had been out 10 years, and there were two Star Wars by then.
Three, even. Yeah.
It was the only genre I hadn't covered, right?
I covered
the West in Blazing Saddles, the horror film with young Frankenstein. Right. And it was like an untouched, beautiful, virgin field for me to soil.
Mel goes back, you know, from Show of Shows, working with people in a room, a bunch of writers, and whoever shouts the loudest gets a line.
Yeah.
And we've got into that spirit of that kind of talk writing, and the girl would write something down and say, we said, do we say that? No, cut that out, you know.
Yeah.
And page by page, it was built that way. You like to start at the very beginning, scene one, and work through.
Yeah, I don't like outlines, really.
Yeah.
I sometimes work from outlines, but I don't like outlines. I like to get a sense of where the story should go.
Right.
Start at the beginning and get very detailed and very busy immediately, which is not the normal process for writing. To me, nothing works unless the audience really understands the premise. So in the early scenes, literally the first scene, and I could teach this, I could teach it with the producers, because when Bialystok meets Bloom, you get the premise. Bloom is a little accountant, Bialystok is a failed producer, he's done nothing but failures. Bloom says, casually, you can make more money with a flop than you could with a hit.
How?
Yeah. That's how
is the whole play.
And then we take the time right at the beginning to explain in detail. If you raise a lot more money than you need and you write or produce a flop, then the IRS and your investors don't care because they've lost their money.
Right.
But you've got to raise 100 times, actually 1,000%, right? Was that in the producers? It's 1,000%.
Yeah, 1,000%.
So exposition is critical because without information, it's just a series of picaresque or comedy adventures. And sometimes those things work and sometimes they don't. But with information.
Well, in Spaceballs, we begin with the information about that the Spaceballs are running out of air.
What's our plot?
Well, it's simple. Yeah. Spaceballs have used up all of their precious air.
These are bad guys.
And these are bad guys.
They're aggressors.
And there's a beautiful big planet. Planet Druidia has enough air.
Planet Druidia.
They're going to steal Planet Druidia's air. And there's 10,000 years of great air, fresh air. And the Planet Druidia is locked in some kind of sealed shield that you have to get the combination to. So they're searching for this combination, which later turns out to be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 is the secret combination.
I know. And President Scroob, who I play, says, wow, instead of saying, what a dumb, stupid combination, he says, wow, what a coincidence. I have that same combination on my luggage. So he's an asshole. But right. Anyway, it all
he's
works.
A spaceball and an
but
asshole.
What I'm saying is that we work detail in a detail sense from the beginning, because the beginning carries most of the explanation or the exposition or the storyline.
And, right. And without that, so we know that, what you're talking about.
And without that, you're lost. But if you have a very strong little plot to begin with, then you can go astray or go awry, as Bobby Burns would say.
Right, but we have Colonel Sanders tell us all to Dark Helmet in the first scene in the spaceship. And then Dark Helmet turns to the audience and says, did you get that?
Yes.
After yeah. he's done the about three and sentences of exposition.
Exposition is critical.
Yeah.
And without exposition, without it's as old fashioned as cavemen who have had a hunt, and you know, maybe they lost Moishe because the great big bear that they were trapping to eat stepped on his balls and killed him. And so they tell about this around the campfire.
Yeah, yeah.
And then Og went so-and-so and Moog went this way, but Moishe got under the and it got his balls crushed. And, yeah, and they all laugh. Yeah. But that's telling the story. It goes back to telling the story of the day, yeah. You know, in a repast of, you know, of cooked bear meat or something.
But what we found in Spaceballs, and what you did in a lot of other pictures, we make the exposition funny.
We got caught up in the fairy tale aspect, didn't
yeah.
we?
Yeah, we kept
and we actually made it more of a fairy tale. More of a kind of Disney-ish.
Right.
With Dick Van Patten becoming this kind of...
Right, in the...
Disney-ish king, you know.
Exactly, in the kind of idyllic world of planet Derridia, as opposed to the outer space world. They didn't have that in Star Wars.
Why did we say Druidia?
We were working that she could say she was Druish.
Ah.
Right. And so
all we need is a Druish princess.
Right. Wow,
okay,
right,
so we so worked. That's why we said Druidia. I was right. wondering, because it should have been Arcadia. Which
or whatever.
Been,
yeah, it could have been, but yeah. Druidia was really good. And good. Is that, you know, the Druids, it's sort of like an old...
The Druids are an old Celtic
myth
or something. Right?
So it fit into the romance of it all. But.
And we had somebody that she didn't want to marry.
Oh, right.
She had a, you know...
The bored prince.
The bored prince,
the
right.
Boring and bored prince, yeah.
So she got into her... Was it a... We called it a Mercedes?
We called it a Mercedes, right. Fully loaded.
Fully loaded
she
Mercedes,
took off in
the
Mercedes.
Right. And escaped. And then we wrote a nice little story, as I remember, yeah. watching it again, that Lone Star is called by the king and says, I'll give you... anything if you save my daughter, and then immediately starts bargaining, you know. And at the end he says, well, if you could, you know, if you could get back the Mercedes spaceship, that would be nice too,
right,
you know.
Right.
That's an old grandmother story. You know, getting a spaceship back? Let me explain.
Oh, yeah.
There's an old Jewish grandmother on a beach. Mm-hmm. It's a classic little, and she's walking with her little grandson. And they walk too close to the ocean, and suddenly a huge wave tears the little grandson from her hand and takes him into the sea, and he's lost. She can't find him. He's gone. He's gone into the sea, and he doesn't surface, and she crashes to her knees on the beach, and she says, oh, God, please, please, I'll do anything. I'll send my little grandson back to me. Send my little grandson. He's such a nice boy. Please save him for me. Oh, God, and suddenly... And in answer to her prayers, the next wave, plop, the little boy goes flying back from that wave onto the beach again. Perfectly fine. Takes his grandmother's hand and begins walking again. And she says, oh, God, thank you, Lord, thank you. By the way, he had a little red cap. So if you spot that, you know.
Right.
So, I mean, so that was the genesis. Right. Of the Dick Van Patten joke. By the way, she had a little Mercedes, you know, yeah, fully loaded.
Yeah,
if
like
you could find
you
that one,
that,
too,
exactly.
We'd get it back, you know.
Right.
So, I mean, what we're saying is that there are roots, you know. Very little is completely original, you know. But writing anything is like tiny little bits of coral. They're infinitesimal at the beginning. You can't hardly see what coral is made of. But you give it a couple of 100,000 years, maybe a couple of million years, and suddenly you've got Hawaii. I mean, there's a mountain,
well,
there's
that,
an island.
Yeah.
So jokes are built on folk tales and, you know.
Or just little observations. I mean, yeah. In Spaceballs, there's a door that says, no unauthorized personnel allowed to enter or authorized.
Right. Yeah, we just went a little too far.
Further. Yeah. Nobody could.
We enjoyed writing that.
That kind of joke is
we
just
enjoyed.
Fun,
right? I enjoy writing with Tom because he's a very funny guy. Everybody thinks it's a myth. Everybody thinks, well, Tom, he's the Irishman, you know, and you know, Mel is the crazy Jew belly comic, you know, belly laughter, and he yeah. does. Not true. It's not true. Tom comes up with very funny belly laugh jokes, and I come up once in a while with some very good exposition or
well,
some very
Mel
good structure,
comes up with
you know.
The smartest jokes from Mel's usually
oh,
intellectual.
Please, please,
really.
You're right, but please,
right,
please.
But you know, the little references to Dostoevsky and stuff like that that people don't even realize.
Well, we do it for ourselves, you know.
Well, we do it for ourselves.
It doesn't hurt anything if they don't get it.
Yeah.
However, every once in a while, we will think something, you know, works on paper, and then you play it, and you read it, and you know, and it's flat as a pancake. It doesn't work. And then either you say, shoot it, and we'll cut it later, or you say, let's break for 5 minutes, and see, you know, stop the cameras rolling, and see if we can rescue it.
On Spaceballs, we were all there, Ronnie Graham and Mel directing, and we would stand around. We would look at all the takes on the monitor,
you
and then talk.
Yeah, Ronnie Graham was the third part of the triumvirate, the writing triangle, and Ronnie Graham was a bit of a genius, and he was a nervous wreck, and a bit of a pain in the ass, and he'd make
but,
a lot
but
of trouble.
He was our pain in the ass. He was fun.
But he was. We loved him. And we miss him. I don't believe in an ever after. Really don't. I think when you die, it's just quiet, you know. But if there is an ever after, if there is a heaven, then certainly Ronnie Graham, you know, God would have certainly got him there to amuse him, you know.
Very witty, very.
Very funny, very,
very
witty.
Funny.
Adorable. I met him first when Ronnie Graham and I met when I was in Philadelphia doing a show for one of Eddie Cantor's daughters, for Marilyn Cantor. The name of the show, it was a review called Curtain Going Up. And in that review, I wrote a sketch called Of Fathers and Sons. Again, it's kind of a takeoff
of
Turgenev, yeah. But it was really a satire of Death of a Salesman. And Ronnie Graham and Leonard Sillman, it was Leonard Sillman's New Faces of 1952 that was being done.
Right.
Saw this crazy sketch, and they liked it. And with very few changes, we were dying, and we were never going to get out of Philadelphia, but they were on their way to New York. Uh-huh. So I asked Marilyn, you know, is it all right if we take the sketch over to Sillman? She said, fine. And so I met Ronnie Graham, who wrote most of the material for New Faces of 1952.
And now he wrote the opening song.
He wrote the opening song, and he wrote many songs, Penny Candy, and he wrote Miss Logan for Robert Clary. Hmm. And I fell in love with Ronnie, and I said, this guy is good, and he thought I was good. And then, so we were doing New Faces of 1952, and it was a hit. It was actually a very big hit on Broadway. But everybody waited for Eartha Kitt, because she was the big star.
Right.
And everybody waited for Paul Lynde and Alice Ghostly and all these people that were in New Face of 52. Nobody, nobody waited for Ronnie Graham. And he was the last one to come out of the stage door. But I'd wait for him every night so we could have a beer and talk. And he would do this crazy thing. He would push the stage door open and say, give me a break. I gotta live too, you know. You're human beings just like I am. Get away from me. Get away. You know, he'd make him believe there were 1,000 autograph fans, you know. He'd make believe for 10 minutes and then we'd go have a drink, you know, every night. And he was a delicious, wonderful, adorable, funny, funny guy.
For a number of years, he wrote MASH.
He did write. He wrote
so
MASH with Larry Gilmore.
He was a good, solid comedy writer.
We'll miss him, and he is the third missing writer.
He was Spaceballs.
Yeah. We want you to know about. He was a terrific actor, and he did little bits in many movies. In Spaceballs, he played a space priest for us.
He did the wedding.
And he did the wedding, and he was very, You'll see for yourself. He's very, very funny.
By the way, I'm in Spaceballs for about 11 seconds.
Okay, Tom, where are you in Spaceballs?
When they return to planet Druidia, and right. She rushes back to the king. There's the king's minister is standing there in a long gown from the Camelot costume right. set. Stood there all day in about 100 degree heat in that big thing. Wait, that was my big moment.
Did you wear a hat?
I wore a hat.
Yeah.
And right. I'm on camera. You promised me this shot. I remember I'm on camera with my own close-up for about 10 seconds.
I try to cut it out.
It had nothing to do with the
story. I try to cut it out, but your children were tugging at my,
right, their tears.
My legs. And they right. wouldn't let me walk. And they said, please leave Daddy in the movie.
So. My little Hitchcock moment.
So you're in.
Yeah, I'm in.
Forever and ever, if you buy the DVD of Spaceballs.
Look for this face.
Look, look for the minister.
The minister, in the last reel, I guess, yeah. somewhere.
What makes you want to work with mm-hmm. other writers? And even after having done a job with them, done a movie with them, what makes you continue to work with them, you know, because often it's a very emotional relationship and writers do are like, it's like a marriage and you do yeah. have squabbles and you do have terrible quarrels. And for you to go on and do another project, and Tom and I have done many together, betrays a modicum of mutual affection and right. respect.
Well, I have
for
such huge admiration for you, Mel.
I have
incredible.
Too.
And
right, for me,
for
yeah,
you.
No, no.
But you know, yeah. and what the great thing about working with you is that when I come in the morning, I know that somewhere during the day you're going to say something so funny I'm going to fall down on the floor.
Believe me. It's life or death when you're writing, you know, yeah. and these movies come out, and if they don't make any money, you don't work again. So it's...
Well, you spend hours and hours. It's true. In the last few years, I spent more time with you than with my wife, practically. We're
yeah.
always together.
Well, mostly in bed. You know, yeah, right. you and I know you don't sleep with your wife, but you love hugging me. Now, we're kidding. No. But the truth is...
You know, 8 hours a day.
The truth is that when you're a writer yourself, and you're directing, and I directed a lot of movies... I like the writers on the set. I like the writers near me, close to me. And I like the writers actually arguing or protesting or voting on a scene. And years ago, it was very difficult because we didn't have the little television camera that
which recorded, makes a big difference, yeah.
recorded the scene. Now, you do a scene, and there's a television camera attached to your normal
right.
camera and it records a scene and then we all sit around and we see for ourselves
yeah.
whether or not what we intended is working or whether or not mm-hmm. it stinks or we have to do it again or you know and the only I'm not interested in no offense I'm not interested in the cameraman's opinion ever or the assistant director's opinion ever I'm not interested in anybody on the set's opinion of the art of the scene. But I do bow to the opinions of my fellow writers,
right?
Because they had a vision, they had a dream in their minds. They knew a projection of what it should be. And if it's there, they vote yes. And if it isn't there, we do it again. So
yeah.
I'm a little too honest. I want you to trim this so that if I sound arrogant and stupid and, you know, and you think I'm hurting anything, leave it in.
It's back and forth. There is a kind of shadow marriage in a writing collaboration when you spend many hours together. We always talked about doing another Spaceballs, another full movie.
Well, we do have a title.
We have the title in the movie.
What's the title?
Yoda says, see you again, God willing, in Spaceballs 2. The Search for More Money.
The Search for More Money.
Right.
Now that's a good title.
Yeah, right.
Spaceballs 2, The Search for More Money.
Right. And we, of course, in Spaceballs, we have all the big merchandise.
We were very brave. I'm surprised that we weren't, you know, that the industry didn't come down on our heads for making fun of them, you know.
Merchandise.
For telling the truth about merchandising being more important than the art of the movie.
Yeah, Yoda pulls out the favorite little toy, the flamethrower, but just... The kids love this one.
Merchandising. Shh, the kids love this one. Yeah. I see on your left elbow, down below your left elbow, is Greg, sitting there like an elf,
all right.
waiting to ask some kind of, you know, to move on to other aspects.
So you mean this conversation is just the two of us?
No, it's not.
Great.
You know, there are cameras here.
Oh.
And there are all kinds of Gentiles and things and olives, and there's all kinds of stuff around here, you know.
Who knew that?
Yeah. You don't want me to go this way, right?
If you can avoid it.
Is this too much? You can tell me.